So what is Web 3.0? And is it really the future of the internet? And will it really challenge the tech giants such as Facebook and Google? On today's CoinMarketCap episode, we will discover what Web 3.0 is and how it came to be, and also what the future holds, and more importantly, how it's going to revolutionize the world that we live in. My name is Trev, and here at CoinMarketCap, we love making videos about all things crypto, from crypto news to market moves, and to educational videos just like the one you're watching right now. So if you want something more than just hype and to actually learn about crypto, make sure to hit the subscribe button down below and also to turn on notifications so you're not going to miss out on any of our videos. So without further ado, let's get into today's video. On October 4th, the online world came to a standstill as Facebook, WhatsApp, and Instagram suffered a major outage, leaving little to no access for billions of users for about 6 hours. This occurrence is not the first of its kind, but it's the largest so far. In just those 6 hours, the outage had managed to cause global ripple effects, disrupting primary communications for millions and halting the operations of thousands of businesses depending on its continuous operation. The outage revealed a problem most internet users were previously unaware of: the dangers of relying on shared infrastructure and centralized platforms. Why can't the internet be opened up so we don't suffer from the dangers of a shared infrastructure? Not only that, but an internet where all users can access whatever they want and have complete ownership of their own data and information. After all, centralized Web 2.0 networks like Facebook and Google collect your personal data, categorize audiences into demographics, and monetize your data by showing you targeted ads. The severity of these issues has even begun to change the general public's opinion, with people looking for alternatives beyond the centralized platforms, and it's quickly gaining momentum. It's time for Web 3.0, the next evolution of the internet. But to better understand the future, we need to understand the past and where we came from. Let's quickly go over the first iteration of the web, Web 2.0, and then we're gonna dive deeper into the unique features of Web 3.0. Web 1.0 is where it all began. Web 1.0 is also called the static web, and it was the first and most reliable internet in the 1990s, when there was just a set of static HTML web pages that could be read and browsed but could not be interacted with, and it's referred to as the read-only web. Back in the day, creating user pages or even commenting on articles wasn't a thing. Think of Web 1.0 as a library, where you can use it as a source of information, but you cannot contribute to it or change the information in any way. Web 1.0 didn't have algorithms to sift internet pages, which made it extremely hard for users to find relevant information. Simply put, it was like a one-way highway with a narrow footpath where content creation was done by a select few, and information came mostly from directories. Simply put, it was slow. Web 2.0 made the internet a lot more faster and more interactive thanks to advancements in web technologies like JavaScript, HTML5, CSS3, and so on. It enabled startups to build interactive web platforms such as YouTube, Facebook, Wikipedia, and many more. Web 2.0 paved the way for social networks and user-generated content production to flourish, since data can be distributed and shared between various platforms and applications. Think of Web 2.0 as a big group of friends and acquaintances. You can still use it to receive information, but you can also contribute to the conversation and make it a richer experience. However, with all of the new opportunities given to independent creators, Web 2.0 is not exactly equal. Platforms like Facebook, Instagram, and Twitter are not entirely free. And there's a saying in the tech world: if you're not paying for it, you are the product. And these platforms operate in this model. They do not exactly grant you free access to their products. Instead, they want you to trade your attention and data in exchange for billions worth of ad revenue. And many issues come with this model, but they all arise from one principle: centralization. Apps like Google, Facebook, and Twitter are basically middlemen that benefit massively from connecting users with each other. Think about it. There are platforms that rent out space for users to share content while collecting all that data for personalized advertisement. In an age of increased demand for data privacy and control, Web 2.0 is ripe for change, and this is where Web 3.0 comes in. Web 3.0 is the future of the internet, which will be decentralized and privacy conscious. Decentralization here means no central point of control, no middleman, and no control over users' data. Web 3.0 is a fair and transparent network where people will interact without the fear of loss of security or privacy. Think of Web 3.0 as a giant database. While Web 2.0 uses the internet to make connections between people, Web 3.0 will use the internet to connect with information. In Web 3.0, no permission is needed from a central authority to post anything. There is no central controlling node, so no single point of failure, and no kill switch. This is essentially the vision of Web 3.0, a truly decentralized network. There's a common misconception that Web 3.0 just means blockchain technology and cryptocurrencies. While blockchain technology is a vital part of the equation, Web 3.0 is much more than that. So the first point is openness, and the network is built using open source software by a community of developers and a full view of the world. And then we also have trustless. Participants can interact with each other privately or publicly without the need of a trusted third party. And the next one is permissionless. Anyone can participate in the network without requiring authorization from a governing body. And more importantly, Web 3.0 will connect users like never before, returning the power of the internet to its true owners, the people. So it sounds pretty exciting, right? Let's look a bit deeper and see some of the key features of Web 3.0. So let's first start with ubiquity. And ubiquity means being or having the capacity to be everywhere, especially at the same time. For example, Web 2.0 is already ubiquitous. A Facebook user can instantly capture an image and share it. It becomes ubiquitous since it's available to anyone, no matter where they are, as long as they have Facebook access. So Web 3.0 simply takes this a step further by making the internet accessible to everyone anywhere and at any time. At some point, internet-connected devices will no longer be concentrated on computers and smartphones like Web 2.0, since Internet of Things technology will bring plenty of new types of smart devices. With Web 3.0, content is accessible by multiple applications. Every device is connected to the web and can be accessed anywhere, so there's no need for a middleman, and in this case, Facebook as our example. So the next point is the semantic web. Semantics is the study of the relationship between words. Therefore, the semantic web, according to Bernice Lee, enables computers to analyze loads of data from the web, which includes content, transactions, and links between persons. So you may be asking to yourself, how exactly would that work? So let's take a look at these two examples. Their syntax may be different, but their semantics are pretty much the same, since semantics only deals with the meaning or emotion of the content. Currently, the web structure makes it easy for you to visit a web page and understand what it's all about. Computers can't do that. A search engine might be able to scan for keywords, but it cannot understand how those keywords are used in the page's context. Applying semantics in the web would enable machines to decode meaning and emotions by analyzing data. Consequently, internet users will have a better experience driven by enhanced data connectivity. And the next point is artificial intelligence. AI will play a crucial role in making the web semantic. In Web 3.0, computers can understand and process information like humans in order to provide faster and more relevant results, and they become more intelligent to help the needs of users. Although Web 2.0 presents similar capabilities, it is still mostly human-based, which opens up room for corrupt behavior such as biased product reviews and rigged ratings, etc. For example, we all use Amazon, and we all read the reviews before purchasing something. Unfortunately, a company listing a new product on Amazon can simply gather a large number of people and pay them to create positive reviews for its under-deserving products. Therefore, the internet needs AI to learn how to distinguish the genuine from the fake in order to provide reliable data. Also, a few months ago, Google's AI system removed around 100,000 negative reviews of the Robinhood app from the Play Store, following the GameStop trading debacle when it detected attempts of rating manipulation intended to downvote the app artificially. This is AI in action, which will soon easily fit into Web 3.0, enabling blogs and other online platforms to filter through data and tailor them to each user's liking. As AI advances, it will ultimately be able to provide users with the best filtered and unbiased data. AI will help websites understand users better, faster, and smarter. And the next one is spatial web and 3D graphics. Some futurists also call Web 3.0 the spatial web, as it can virtually take you anywhere, helping you learn about different places and ideas by experiencing them as if you were actually there. Indeed, this vision forms from the basis of the metaverse, which is a digital universe where people can work, play, socialize, and do business just as they would in the real life, but without actually having to travel anywhere. For example, with Web 3.0, you won't have to travel hundreds of miles to another city to examine a new house. The web can allow you to search for things visually by pointing your camera lens at them through augmented reality. A good example of this is the Google Lens. You can search for things on Google without having to type a single word. You only have to scan an object with the Google Lens, and the web will do the rest. And this brings us to the applications of Web 3.0. So how can we apply Web 3.0 to the real world? In Web 3.0, applications will run on decentralized networks of numerous peer-to-peer nodes, utilizing blockchain technology or combining the two. With no central server and a system that encourages equal network ownership, users need no permission to participate in the network. Web 3.0 is, however, best captured by cryptocurrencies. These digital tokens are one of the best representations of a departure from a central controlling authority that is the central banks. Cryptocurrencies will be essential in and creating financial incentives for anyone willing to contribute or to improve a project. So let's take a look at a few of the Web 3.0 applications that aim to disrupt the web's original disruptors. The first one is Stemit, which is a Web 3.0 social network. Stemit is a social media platform where everyone gets paid for creating and curating content. Stemit is decentralized with zero entry barriers that allow users and creators to retain ownership over their content and earn a stake in the technology, the platform itself, by adding valuable content to it. Instead of sharing and commenting on content for free via a third party that mines and monetizes your personal data and uses proprietary algorithms to decide who actually sees what you share, Stemit aims to provide a social news service where users get paid to upvote, comment, and post, with content creators earning reputation-based rewards. And the next one is Store, which is a Web 3.0 cloud storage. The future of cloud storage is decentralization. Imagine being able to rent out your extra hard drive space through an autonomous network and being paid for it in cryptocurrency. Well, thanks to Satoshi Nakamoto and platforms like Store, this is made possible. Store is a Web 3.0 application which offers decentralized, secure cloud storage. The fundamental technologies underlying Store are encryption, file shading, and hash table on blockchain to organize file storage in a peer-to-peer network. Web 3.0 cloud storage offers superior privacy with lower vulnerability to hackers and government snoops. Files are stored in small pieces across multiple hard drives so that only the owner has a complete copy. And the next one is Wolfram Alpha, which is a Web 3.0 search engine. Wolfram Alpha is a computational knowledge engine that answers your questions. Students and professionals from different fields like mathematics, nutrition, science, and others all use it. This platform uses Web 3.0 to gather information from databases across the web and simplify the information for end users. Wolfram Alpha answers your questions directly by computation, as opposed to giving you a list of web pages like search engines do. So if you want a practical comparison, search England versus Brazil on both Wolfram Alpha and Google and see the difference. Google gives you the results of the World Cup, even if you didn't include football as a keyword, since it is the most popular search. And on Alpha, on the other hand, would give you a detailed comparison of the two countries, like you asked. And that's the key difference from Web 2.0 and Web 3.0. The Web 3.0 transformation has already started. The new internet will provide a more personal and customized experience, a smarter and more human-like search assistance, and other decentralized benefits that hopefully will help to establish a more equitable web. So the only question that remains is, do you want to be just a user, or do you want to be an owner?